to move me on something he's been dealing with me already, but in Elements, if you were there, a couple people began to mention a change of perspective. And there was a time when I wasn't living for the Lord and I was playing college baseball. And I was going to go visit this big college, and they were going to make me a huge offer. And the night before, Brother Shannon, they called me and said, something happened. I couldn't. Your classes won't transfer. And I had a 4.0 GPA. And in that moment, I thought, what in the world? But as you know, in hindsight, in perspective backwards, I see what the Lord was doing, Brother Tripp, because I serve a God who works things together for good. When I look back, he was lining stuff up for me to be here right now. Our God, your God is lining stuff for you in this moment. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you showed up here with, but we can change our perspective. And how that verse starts is with our praise, because it was Paul and Silas at midnight in the prison. They begin to say praises unto the Lord. And the atmosphere changed. Your situation, your atmosphere today, it changed with your praise.
Thank you.
Amen. We're just here to worship Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to take up our tithing and offering at this time. We got many different ways to give. We got Giveify, PayPal, available at riverbendpentecostals.com. Cash and checks can be mailed to Riverbend Pentecostals, P.O. Box 477, New Madrid, Missouri 63869. We also have text to give, and that number should put up there. We also have the tithing, the two closest pans, and then the offering on the two outer pans. Amen. I was talking to the youth this morning, and I feel like it was the same way in our finances, but you get what you give. It's the same way. Sister Marie, I don't give to get, but the Lord will honor what you give, and He will bless you for giving. Brother Blake, it may not be financially. We talk about that a lot, how many times we give financially, and the Lord will keep your hand, keep His hand on you. He'll keep you protected when you're out there. He'll keep you a covering place around you and your children. Amen. So let's give freely today, because the Lord's blessed me. Amen. Say this prayer with me. Upon the authority of your word I have given, and it shall be given unto me. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am the tither, and I give my offerings. I bring them today to your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked, the curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises. back there into this service today that you need God to take care of. Did you wake up this morning not feeling well? Did you wake up this morning and you just got problem after problem after problem after problem? Things that just keep coming into your life that made you want to just stay home today. What did you have in your life this morning that battled you from coming to the house of the Lord? And even when you got here, what are you still dealing with? I know just for us up here this morning, we've had sound issues. We've had all kinds of things going on. And it just seems like things aren't going right. And whenever we were trying to come out of the house this morning, we had some issues that rose up that I just felt like, you know what, we might as well just stay home this morning. But you know what, Brother Shannon, we're here this morning. We're here to praise God. We're here to give Him the glory. We're here to magnify Him. And I just want to ask you again, what did you have going on in your life this morning that you were able to fight through and that you were still able to come to the house of the Lord and you're still able to magnify Him? You're still able to look past your troubles. You're still able to look past your needs and your desires, but you came this morning to the house of the Lord to worship Him. To be with like-minded people, to be with people who share the same faith with you. But you were able to come together this morning just to seek after Him for a little while. I just want to let you know this morning, we can come up here and we can have this time of prayer because it's what we do every Sunday. But Brother Blake, I just want to tell you, I appreciate what you said this morning. You were talking about Paul and Silas briefly. This could be your midnight hour. This could be the time that you're in your worst trouble. This could be the time where you're facing the darkest night. This could be your midnight moment right here. And I want to ask you, what are you going to do with it? If you will just get up, if you will just praise Him, if you will dance your way into glory, and you will shout your way into a victory, you'll see what God can do. I don't feel like we need to necessarily beg and plead and cry to God right now. Whatever you're dealing with, if you will just praise Him, you would just give Him the glory, and you would just shout for victory in the house today. Those chains are going to fall off. The things that have you bound are going to fall off. And you're going to be able to walk right out of the prison, right out of the circumstance that you were in. So church, we're about to do another song. It doesn't matter what the words say. It doesn't matter if it's slow. It doesn't matter if it's fast. It doesn't matter what you're going through. But if you will get just this morning in the house of the Lord, see what He's going to do for you. Let Him be God today. If you were ever going to step out of the way and let the Lord be the Lord, let it be right now. In Jesus' name.
Turn it around. Thank you. this people need to be able to pray all throughout the service. That's part of our culture, because he said it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer. And when somebody wants to pray, wants to pray for, wants to pray alone, wants to pray with, do it. And we have about 8 or 10 altar calls of service sometimes, if you want to call on that. But I feel like I have a word from the Lord. I've been praying. Maybe you'll just kind of let it flow and see what happens. But this is a word for today. It's a word for us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. If Jesus Christ didn't come to condemn the world, neither did you. Or me. But that the world through him might be saved. We'll read a few more scriptures, and then we'll let you be seated. Genesis 18, 20 through 33. And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done all together according to the cry of it which is coming to me. And if not, I will know. And the men turned their faces from thence and went towards Sodom. But Abraham stood yet before the Lord. And Abraham drew near and said, wilt thou also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Peradventure there be 50 righteous within the city, wilt thou also destroy and not spare the place for the 50 righteous that are therein? That be far from thee to do after this manner, to slay the righteous with the wicked, and that the righteous should be as the wicked that be far from thee. Shall not the judge of the earth do right? And the Lord said, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the place for their sakes. And Abraham answered and said, behold, now I take it upon me to speak to the Lord, which am but dust and ashes. Peradventure there shall lack 5 of the 50. Will thou destroy all the city for lack of 5? And he said, if I find 45 there, I won't destroy it. And he spake to him again and said, peradventure there be 40 found. And he said, I won't do it for 40's sake. And he said unto him, oh, let the Lord not be angry, and I will speak. Peradventure there be 30 found there. And he said, I will not do it if I find 30 there. Abraham said, behold, now I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord. Peradventure there should be 20 found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for 20's sake. It's taken me a long time to read it. I hope Abraham's not getting on your nerves. The Lord said, I won't destroy it for 20's sake. And he said, oh, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak yet but this once. Peradventure 10 shall be found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for 10's sake. And the Lord went his way as soon as he had left communion with Abraham. And Abraham returned unto his place. Today, by the help of the Lord, for I don't know how long, I'm going to speak to you on this subject. Will there be 10? Will there be 10? God, I love you today. Man, your presence is powerful. The worship has been good. Some of us are disconnected. I pray, Lord, that there will be a spirit of connectivity that will sweep into this house. And that, Lord, everyone here will connect not just with each other, but with you, with your purpose, and with their calling according to your purpose. I pray, God, that there will be a manifestation of revelation and validation loosed in this house. And those that came for the fishes and the loaves, that they too will find satisfaction from the word of God. I pray these things, Lord, according to your word and your promises. We try to live out what you put in us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Several years ago, I can't remember how long now, I'm thinking 10 at least, maybe 12, something like that. One day we were at the house, Amanda, myself, and Carly. I think the boys were, of course, still there, but they were probably somewhere younger. And I did something goofy. I don't know what it was. It doesn't even matter what it was, but it's kind of a regular occurrence, at least according to my children, that I did something goofy. Carly said, "Dad, you're not on 10 today." Now, obviously, I had no clue in the world what that meant, except I knew that it had something to do with me being goofy. So, since then, anytime she does anything goofy, I tell her, "Carly, you ain't on 10 today." I don't think it's all that cool anymore, but I still like it. So I looked it up, and it really referring to if somebody said, "How are you doing today?" And they said, or how was, here we go, "How was the sermon today?" And you say 10 out of 10, then everybody pretty much knows that it's a universal good job, right? Did good. So on 10 literally means it was a 10 out of 10. The word, let me say this first. If you've not done any numeric studies in the Bible, you need to, because numbers have a big importance in the Bible. And the number of days, the number of people, the number of tribes, and number of days of creation, they all have significance in how many there are. The number 10, biblically speaking, means authority, completeness of order, and responsibility. It was to that number that the Lord and Abraham arrived at to say, "We will not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah if you can find 10 righteous." Now the impetus for this sermon is that yesterday I had something else to preach, and I came to my office and I began to pray, and I was thinking about the tragedy in Kansas City and how now they have booked two juveniles, two children with that horrible, horrible crime, and one was killed and 22 were injured. And then even in our town here, I saw yesterday where there was some juveniles that went around stealing things out of people's cars. And I've heard teachers and people that work at the school talking about how nobody wants to teach and how nobody knows what to do with the kids. And I hear stories where it seems like the kids are running the school now instead of the administrators and the teachers running the school. The kids tell us what they want and then we have to do it. And so my mind was carrying that weight yesterday. And when I knelt to pray, Sister Maria, it was kind of like a hopeless prayer. Like everything is so messed up and everything is so out of order. God, can even you fix something like this? And the Lord said, "I would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah and the other two cities of the plain if I would have just found 10 righteous people." The Lord said, through the power of the Holy Ghost, "You can turn the tide of any society, of any country, of any generation, of any group of people, no matter how far they've gone away to the left or how far they've gone away to the right. If you've got the Holy Ghost and you can pray, you can make a difference in this world." This morning I said to the men in our early morning discussion with coffee and stuff, I said, "Think about this. If God cleaned your life from the minute you prayed until the day you were born, every sin, every bit of debauchery, every bit of ungodliness and rebellion that you've ever committed, the Lord washed you whiter than snow in one prayer. What do you think we could do if we would begin to pray that same effectiveness over our world? We have got to turn it around. We have got to be blessed. Even those hurt your feelings, even those even movie stars and music stars and stars who just got on social media and got famous for nothing and got rich. And it's frustrating when you work hard and you try to do right and all these people making millions. The Lord sent me today to tell you, Tim will make a difference. Tim biblically means authority, completeness of order, and responsibility. How many of y'all trying to count up 10? In Judaism, the rabbis regard the number 10 as a cohesive system of smaller parts that come together to create something whole. This belief, I feel Jesus, this belief is why the rabbis regard 10 to stand for holiness. Something holy enough as a whole, something that when the parts come together, it is holy enough as a whole that whatever God creates out of it becomes a resting place for His presence. In effect, the 10 righteous would become the mercy seat, where the Shekinah glory would come down and rest. Yes, in Sodom and Gomorrah. Let's think about it a minute, the tithing principle. The word tithe means tenth. And the way the tithing principle works is that when we give God the first tenth of all of our increase, somebody say amen.
Amen.
That's what the book says. The first tenth of our increase, it declares that we know that all of it belongs to Him. And the first tenth, the sanctification of the first tenth carries over to the whole. When you give God the first, you ain't supposed to be talking about money in church, but hey, when you give God the first tenth, it makes the 90 holy and sanctified. Ten. The Ten Commandments written on the tablets of stone were not the only commandments that the Lord gave Moses that day. You recall we taught you that there are 613 different commandments in the law given to Moses for the people of God. But the first ten, universally known as the Ten Commandments, reflect and represent the whole law of God. The first five commandments deal with our relationship with God. The second five commandments deal with our relationship with others. Again, representing the gathering together of different parts, creating a whole, a place where God can rest. It was at 10 righteous, having begun at 50, that both Abraham and God rested on 10. As representative of the mercy of God, withholding judgment upon the whole, just 10 righteous. There is a pending calamity in our world. The cry from the depths of depravity reflected in our youth and schools, in our entertainment, in our heroes, and even in our churches, that has no doubt reached the throne of God. There is an intercessor who will step up and stand in the gap. More powerful, the question is, will there be 10 who will provide a resting place for the presence of God? Among the obstinate and the unholy, among the stubborn and the wicked, even among those who willfully align themselves with the spirit of Antichrist that is rampant and steadily rising in our world. In John 3:16, the most powerful and operative word in that passage, in my opinion, is so. It is the measurement declaration that propelled heaven into earth.
That level of love that in spite of the sin and turmoil and rebellion and rampant ungodliness that consumed the world, that very world that he so loved, that he gave, subjecting himself to any number of contradictions, up to and including the lies and deception into which Calvary's cross was planted. He did this because Jesus is the ultimate intercessor. Isaiah 59 and 16, and he saw that there was no man. And he wondered, he was amazed, he was perplexed that there was no intercessor. Therefore his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness, it sustained him. The New Living Translation, the last half of verse 16 says, so he himself stepped in to save them with his strong arm, and his justice sustained him. His righteousness sustained him. Hebrews 9 and 24 says, for Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the truth, but he's entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God. Everybody say, for us. For us. 1 John 2 and 1. My little children, I write these things to you, that you sin not. But if you sin, but if any man sin, we have an advocate, Jesus, with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. We have an intercessor. We have one who will stand in the gap for us, one who can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. But when he comes to earth looking, you notice, Brother Jerry, that he said, I'm going to go down to Sodom and I'm going to check things out. I'm going to look beyond the surface into the inside of men. I'm going to go and find out if it's really that bad. Yeah. When he comes looking, Luke 17, 7 and 8, and shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? It will be the cry of his people. It will be your cry. We have those here today that are struggling with disease and illness and sickness. We have those here today that are struggling with addictions and other hurts, habits, and hang-ups. We have those here today that are struggling with family difficulties and marriages and difficulty with their families and with their children. We have those here today who are struggling with difficulties on the job. And we have those here that lie awake at night perplexed at the destiny and at the nature of the debauchery and the sin and the depravity of our world. So it will be your cry and your struggles and your war and your facing your enemy with endurance that will reach out to God for help. But who will intercede for those who don't yet know they need his help? Who will intercede for those who reject him? Who will intercede for those who make fun of him, who ridicule him, who watch a movie star or somebody famous get on a TikTok, Facebook, the Reel, CNN, Fox, etc., and malign and mistreat and talk ugly about Christians and about their Lord? Who's going to intercede for them? Will the 10? You see, as I preach it to you today, that is any number of believers who will come together in the righteousness of God in the middle of this untoward generation and create a resting place for God, and thereby hold back the fire of judgment. They blaspheme him. They malign him. They speak ill of him and ugly of him. They malign us and what we believe. They talk about us. They are becoming living witnesses of the end time. disrespectful to their parents, disrespectful to authority, having unnatural affection, selfish, incontinent. They have lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Will there be 10? Luke 9, 51 through 56. And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, almost the end. Almost the end, Brother Richard. Almost the time for his work to be finished. The time has come that he should be received up. He steadfastly, resolutely, strongly made a decision to go to Jerusalem. Brother David, it was the time. It was the place where he would be rejected. First accepted, then rejected. It was there they would find him guilty and end up hanging him on a cross outside of town. But on the way, he hadn't got there yet, and he's going to pass through Samaria. So he sends his disciples, James and John, along to find a place for the master to spend the night. Because he wasn't coming. Apparently, because he wasn't coming to stay, the Samaritans told James and John, "We don't have a place for Jesus here." They rejected him. Verse number 52. Sent messengers before his face, and they went into the village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. 53. And they did not receive him. That's the Samaritans. They rejected him. The Lord said, "Can I come?" The Lord said, "Can I come stay with you?" And they said, "We don't have a place for you." They rejected him. They said, "No." They turned their back on him. They rejected him. "We don't want you here." James and John, the disciples with him, the sons of thunder, many say, given that title because they got a hot temper, they say to the Lord, "Would you allow us?" Just like Elijah did, to call fire down on them and consume them. We're Brother Larry. God's doing something in here. He's doing something. We're fighting it. But he's doing something. And when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, "Lord, wilt thou, will you allow us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" Even as Elijah did. Are you getting the picture? They were mean to the Lord. And in their mind, that was worth killing them for. Let us call fire down from heaven. And it's going to be the Lord doing the work, Brother Johnny. Because we feel like we're aligned with the Lord when we come against all these horrible people. We feel like we're lined up with the Lord when we stand up and we holler back at them. We tell them what we believe, bless God. And if they don't like it, they can lump it. Maybe God will let me call fire down from heaven and consume them. Well, that will show them with it. Who's right, who's wrong? The Bible says in verse 55. But he turned to them and rebuked them and said, "You do not know what spirit you're of. What you talking about? We just asked you to let us call fire down from heaven and destroy the ones that are against you. They rejected you. They won't accept you. We'd like to kill them. We'd really like heaven to help us do it." Right? He said, "You don't even know what manner of spirit you are of." Next verse. "For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." Wait a minute. That don't jive people that love him, but they just got off track a little bit. What about those that use his name in vain? What about those that damn him and curse him? What about those that make fun of the Bible and make fun of the created order? And what about those that thumb their nose at the Lord? We should be able to take them out, right? But you don't know what spirit you're of. Because the Son of Man has not come to destroy men's lives. You mean to tell me that you want me to intercede for people I don't even like? You mean to tell me that you want me to intercede for people that don't even say the blessing over their food? You mean to tell me that you want me to intercede for people that are mean and ugly and vindictive and they ridicule and they make fun? The carnal mind says, circle the wagons. And let's just try to hold on to what we got till Jesus comes. But Jesus said, you don't know what spirit you love. I didn't come to destroy men's lives. I came to save them. We cannot give up. Jesus is coming. But until he comes, the call for 10 resonates over the portals of heaven. He will intercede. Who's going to go be my hands? Who's going to go be my feet? Who's going to go be my eyes and be my mouth and be my ears? Who's going to stand in the gap and be the 10 righteous for which I will spare an entire region of people? 10 souls, 10 hearts, 10 units coming together in the middle of this mess. And proclaiming and practicing the love of God to this present world, to create a place. Right where the devil is. Right in the middle of the devil's kingdom, where the mercy seat will accept the presence of God. You young people, hear me. It's not just your most important thing. It's not standing up there singing and becoming part of the praise team and instruments. But you every day are waking up and putting on your clothes and packing your lunch and riding the bus into the one of the devil's biggest strategic locations.
Yeah.
Yeah. Praying and God come. I don't know. The Holy Ghost sent me to tell you I can find 10.
Yeah.
If I can find 10, I'd make a difference. I hope we're not boring you this morning. I hope this is not like old hat. I hope somebody will say, I believe I can make a difference.
Yeah.
I believe. You see, Brother Derek, we're not going in my righteousness anyway. I'm going in his righteousness. And what we learned about being a servant of God in elements today, which you do need to be a part of.
Amen.
You know what it does? It doesn't put the pressure on. It takes the pressure off.
Yeah.
It doesn't put the clamps on. It takes the clamps off. It leads me into a place of freedom where I turn loose all of me. Yes, I know I've been stupid. Yes, I know I've failed. Yes, I know I've made mistakes. seated for just a moment. 10 souls, 10 parts, units. 10, you understand the way I'm preaching, 10 might be 50. 10 might be 31. 10 might be 172. We can come together and proclaim and practice the love of God in this present world. Titus chapter 2, verse number 11. I've come to a close. The musicians can come. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. God's going to put a burden on somebody right now for the wealthy. I would argue that there's more intimidation reaching out to the wealthy and to the upper crust of society than there ever is to somebody living in the gutter. Because we're not convinced that they need him. Ladies and gentlemen, they don't have to be convinced they need him. We have to be convinced they need him. As I started to get over it this morning, and you know I preach it a lot, so I'm going to preach it again. Everybody can't be a prayer center. Everybody can't be a keyboard player. Everybody can't work in the media booth. And everybody can't play the bass and the guitar. And everybody can't preach. But you got purpose. That's only like 4 hours out of our week. I pray right now that the Lord puts a knucklehead on your radar. I pray right now that there's somebody on your job that they don't look like you, they don't dress like you, they don't smell like you, they don't talk like you, they don't act like you, and they don't have the same values you do. But tomorrow morning, when you punch the clock, you're not pursuing a paycheck anymore. You're pursuing them. Lord didn't put you here to make a paycheck. Come on, we just read it the other day. They threw out the net and they caught a fish. And the Lord said in his mouth, that's the tax payment. Brother David, it ain't never been a problem for him. All the things we stress about and we worry about. Let me tell you something. This sound system can kick the bucket today. That won't stop revival.
Amen.
For the grace of God, I'm ready to close. This is going to be like a world record short sermon. But I was afraid I might lose you. For the grace of God to bring us salvation that appeared to all men.
Yeah.
Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live. I said we should live. You understand, that's talking about more than just breathing in and out. That's talking more than just existing. That's talking about living. That we should live soberly. Soberly. Anybody y'all sober? Well, we got people that a year ago today, you were blitzed out of your mind. You don't know where you were. You don't know who you were with. And you don't know how you got there. But today, I live. Today, I live. You know why? God's grace is God. And it taught me. It taught me that I could be a soul. What's that next word there? What did he say I'm looking for? Woo, Holy Ghost, help me right now. He taught me. Think about this. You can be one of them I'm looking for. Get ready. You can be one of them I'm looking for. Get ready. I'm going to teach you how to do it. I'm going to show you how to do it. I'm going to empower you to do it. I'm going to do what you need.
didn't come to destroy people's lives. He came to save them. And I'm going to make sure that when I come looking for 10, that you have everything you need to be what I need.
Soberly, righteously, and godly. Where? Why do we keep praying to get out of where we're supposed to be? In this present world, Sister Tina, with all the craziness. You know what he told them to do? He said, occupy until I come. Have you ever looked up what that word occupy means? It doesn't mean just be there. It means be there. Be in charge there. Be in authority there. Why in the world do we feel like we're the ones that got to defend ourselves? When the Bible said, on this rock I'll build my church and the gates of hell. You know what the gates of hell is? All of hell's plans, all of hell's machinations, all of hell's ideas, ideology, everything that little imps and demons and devils get together and say, we're going to do against them. None of it's going to prevail against the church. Verse 13. I'm bringing it home. Wait a second. Looking for that blessed hope. This is what grace does. It helps you be part of the 10 and never lose sight of where you're going. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse 14, God, as you stand with me. Who gave himself for us. Why did he do that? Because he so loved the world. See, something happens, Sister Maria. When we read that, we get tunnel vision. And we think the only face in that lens is ours. I think he meant the word. What kind of a revival are we going to have when we start reaching for people that today don't want to be reached? That today don't want to be prayed for. That if you pray for them, they laugh at you. They go make fun of you. They go back to, are you ready for them to go back to the break room table and make everybody laugh at you because you prayed for them? Are you ready? Or are you going to want to call fire down from heaven and kill them? I got to tell you, to today's message, I've wanted that a few times. You show them, Lord. That's what I want. You show them. Instead, you know what he said? No. You go show them. What I can do with somebody who was a loser. You go show them what I can do with somebody who didn't have faith they needed. You show them who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people. That does not mean weird. That means a people specially for him. Zealous of good works. Verse 15. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. And let no man despise you. We've all, like I said, we've already had several altar calls today. But I'm asking you, will there be 10? I believe already. How many have said this or heard this? I've said it. I'm going on record and saying it. If the Lord don't come soon, he's going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah for lowering the boom on them when our world is like it is. You know they're doing the same things in our streets that Sodom and Gomorrah got zapped for. Why do you think judgment hadn't come yet?
9:10. I believe with all of my heart that the reason the end ain't come is because there's still somebody out there that the 10 have got to hold it back. Maybe they're not ready. Maybe they're not feeling it. Maybe they're not feeling it. I'm going to stand my ground. I'm going to let them beat me down. Why? Why are you going to do that? Because they need it. And who knows whether you come to the kingdom for such a time as this. There's some of you, I'm quitting. I promise. I don't know how many times I've said it already, but I mean it every time. There's some of you in here today that the lost one I'm preaching to you about sleeps in your house. You don't like them. You can't stand being around them. They get on your nerves. They suck the life out of you, and they drag you down. Holy Ghost sent me today to tell you, you may be one prayer meeting away from a breakthrough. It may be one more time that they hear you plead the blood of Jesus over their name. That they say, you know what? I don't know much about this Jesus stuff, but I see what's happening in their life. And no matter what I do with them, no matter how bad I talk about them, no matter how bad I make fun of them, no matter how bad I ridicule them, they never quit. They don't ever stop praying. They don't ever stop believing. They don't ever stop going to church and singing. They don't ever stop giving. They don't ever stop.
Thank you. Aren't you thankful for what we have heard and what we have felt in these places? Couldn't help but think a while ago, we must never take this life. You know, a lot of times we come and we sit in church and ooh, that was a good message, and wow, that's some good singing, and we leave this place. And we saw ourselves, like the Bible says in the Word, we saw a place where we need to change, and then if we're not careful, we'll walk out of these doors and leave the exact same we came. I don't want that to ever happen anymore in my life. But I want to hear the Word, and I want to be a hearer of the Word, but a doer also. Amen? That means I've got to change some things so those around me see a difference. Brother Skipper, so I can help reach those that might be seen. Because with Christ, I can do all things. Amen? Amen? Let's just give him some praise this morning and thank him for his goodness. We have a whole slew of announcements this morning. I don't have no Bible, so it's going to be hard to read, but I'm going to try. So we have no prayer meeting this Monday night due to President's Day. Church cleaning schedule this week is Brother Terrence and his family. Riverbend Ignited Youth Convention is March the 27th through the 29th. Brother Richard needs to know who's planning on going by Sunday, March the 3rd. Wednesday evening, March the 6th, we will have Brother and Sister Zenobia, the missionaries to Spain. Southeast Regional Camp Meeting is March the 7th and 8th at the Black River Coliseum in Papa Bluff, Missouri. Daylight Savings Time service is March the 10th, 2 o'clock p.m. There will be no classes on that day, only church service. Baby shower for Sister Meredith Edwards is March the 9th, 2 p.m. here at the church. RSVP to Sister Sophia, and the number is 573-620-7014 by March the 1st, and she is registered at Baby List. There is a sign-up sheet on the back table for any lady who is interested in doing the 12 steps. The annual business meeting will be Wednesday, March the 13th, 6 p.m. 12 hours of prayer is this coming up Saturday, March the 24th. There is a sign-up sheet in the back on the back table. So all of you that haven't, please make it a point to sign up there. The ladies' night is Monday, February the 26th, 6 p.m. Crazy Socks and Bingo Night, so text Bingo to the church texting number to sign up. And as always, please bring your own drink. Ladies' Conference is April the 25th through the 27th at Chateau on the Lake in Branson. Registration is $70. After April the 8th, it will be $90. And there is a QR code below on this bulletin to register if you would like to register. Do you have any birthdays or any anniversaries in the house this morning? Over the aisle, we got one. He told me he's going to do that. He said he'd bring in a whole slew of people. Brother Jerry told me it had been 5 long years for his anniversary. So I got a feeling after I said that, there probably won't be 5 more. But he will be in the doghouse. All right. Brother Jerry, we're going to have you stand first. Since you fired the first shot, we're going to let you go first. I don't know if she's going to stand with you. But... All right, can we have a birthday stand in the house? God bless you.